Today's foraging seminar is going to be done by Dr. Speer, Dr. Olsen, and Dr. Fitzgerald, and we're all really looking forward to it. It's by the Medical Center for Birds up in Oakley. Anyway, the seminar should be great. All right.
Education in the science of how animals, including birds, learn, why they learn, why they don't learn, how it works, the buzzwords, the terms, how they're applied, and how we can start thinking of the concepts of enrichment, of which one of those is foraging, how we can build a foundation for superior health and welfare and improving that for the animals that we steward. Well, probably first and foremost is this is a, it's a term and it's an application, it's a call to action thing there. And it's because for the most part, as animal owners and on the veterinary side, we just don't really recognize the problems that come from lack of enrichment until they're hitting us in the face. If we don't recognize the problem, that completely shoots us in the foot. We can't be proactive about anything. We can't be preventative about anything. That locks us into a crisis intervention mindset. On the behavioral side, which is really where we're at, yeah, really, really advanced problems, terminal problems, unresolvable problems staring you in the face. Next line. And we fail. Once a feather picker, always a feather picker. Ever heard that line? All of those problems lead to a huge negative impact on health and welfare of birds. That's why you're here. That's why I'm here. We don't like that. So we look at the good old days, and actually the upper left-hand photo you have here is a picture that I took of a freshly released batch of quarantine imported blue-fronted Amazons 25 years ago. They were there to be surgically sexed. They were riddled with herpes virus and pox and worms and all sorts of stuff. And that's kind of how we dealt with them. We crammed 20 birds into little canary cages and moved them around. That's what we thought of collectively in our society of many pet birds 25 years ago. And if you look at the Amazon immediately to the right, you take the seed-eating, peanut-loving, non-social, inactive Amazon that's been living that way for 25 years. That's a Mexican red-headed Amazon. He weighs 720 grams, and he just got sick yesterday. Those are the good old days, and we wanted to think that everything that these animals, these stressed, malnourished, inappropriately cared for animals, they would ultimately break down with bacterial infections as opportunistic things. And we thought that the E. coli and whatever it was, bacteria, was the problem, and it really wasn't, was it? It was just the tip of the iceberg, nothing more, nothing less. So if you look at the far right-hand side, here's a group of newly hatched green-winged macaws born in the USA. No companion pet bird is sold as a pet in the United States as an imported wild-caught animal since the Wild Bird Conservation Act of 1992. Those birds are born and made in the USA. What their lives will be is entirely up to us. You look at the way we manage a group of companion doves in the lower left-hand corner compared to the Amazons above them. Times are good. We're getting better. I want more. And the human role, the benefit we have of interacting with these animals is stunning, isn't it? Birds make us better people if we slow down to understand them. This is a huge reason why we need to learn how to teach and learn with them and from them, because we will be better people. And God knows some of us need it more than others. Okay, next slide. If we think about these newer times, geez, by improving what we do husbandry-wise, we can do certain things. Let's see what comes up. We can do a lot more husbandry maneuvers without being so intrusive and fear-evoking. That's a good thing. What else can we do? We can result in a less of an adverse or negative experience by the birds. That's a good thing. So we can work with them, share our lives with them, and not scare the holy bejesus out of them. Those things result in less risk, less stress, less risk of trauma, less risk of iatrogenic stress-associated medical problems. And the next line is some more buzzwords, less conditioning, learning of things to be afraid of. And we're going to touch on that a lot with some of the learning and the science here. I'm going to give a lot of credit to what we know and think about the way these birds' brains work to Irene Pepperberg because of the work she did with Alex. Huge. He died of arteriosclerosis. We never make it more than a week without seeing pet birds dying of terminal aspects of arteriosclerosis, stroke, and all sorts of bad things. That is the primary reason why you don't feed your birds these high-fat seed diets. And the African species don't get morbidly obese. They look fine until at about 32 when Alex died, they drop dead. And sometimes, many times, they don't drop dead. They suffer horribly with strokes and all the secondary sequelae. So he had arteriosclerosis, hardening of the arteries. We get myocardial infarction. They get carotid arteries, major aortas, the big vessels that you can't replace until you're just dying. So that's a good word on the diet thing. But Irene specifically looked comparatively with birds and other vertebrates on how language and communication learning occurred. And she extended her work further in depth into the first bird species and was able to prove that cognitive reasoning ability is undeniably there, and that the whole definition of animal intelligence went whoop, didn't it? Next slide. And so because of that foundational work, starting about a little more than 20 years ago that she did, the classic view of how the bird brain worked, where you see a lot of the purplish shaded areas on the upper left, is supposed to be the instinctive, autonomic, you know, automatically controlled things, no thought processes. That was the bird brain as a, compared to the superior level of intelligence of the human brain over here. Up here, you can see, gosh, aren't humans just superior beings? Now, no, we're really not. We're about the same. And the whole thing, all the sulci and gyri and the grooves, which gives us a greater degree of cortical reasoning ability and pallial regions within the brain, it's about the same. So we can't really use scientifically the term bird brain as an insult. And many times that's a compliment. And we need to understand that. So let's go to the next slide. Go back, please. What's the blue? The blue is the pallial area, which I believe is kind of your core control center. I couldn't really speak to that. I haven't had to think about that in about 5 years, so I couldn't say. The big thing is, if you look at the green, cognitive thought processes, figuring stuff out, learning. That's what I'm hitting on here. And the green has completely changed. Okay, good question. You caught me. I don't know what that is. All right. Okay, next slide. Okay, so how can these animals with a hell of a lot more green zones learn? There's different categories of learning that's going to occur. Let's whip those out, Jeff. We can learn by habituation, which we'll touch on, aka desensitization. The next one would be classical conditioning, like Pavlov's dog, and we'll get into that. The third one would be operant conditioning, which is the mode that you're going to be teaching your animals to forage and enriching their lives predominantly.